My name is Adrien Jolie. As John just said, I'm in the site search crawler team as a software engineer and also tech lead of that team. But today, I'm not going to talk about that team specifically. I'm going to talk about a topic that has become more important for me as I grow older as a software engineer, which is code quality or writing clean code. So I'm going to tell you a little story of something that happened here and how I reacted to that and what I learned from it. And I will tell you the responses that I found to the problems that I faced. So this is the story of a pull request and the code review. A long, long time ago in a squad not that far away, I met a pull request that looked like that and I had to review it. So I was a bit depressed. I was like, okay, this is going to take a little while. So I look at my calendar and I say, okay, I'm going to block 3 hours to focus on this specific PR and try to make sense of what the author wanted to convey, what was the design decisions that were put, what possible bugs can come out of that PR, et cetera, et cetera. And I put a lot of energy reading it, testing it, et cetera. So it took a little while for me to test everything, to understand the philosophy of the PR and to send some comments and feedback and suggestions on the PR. And after several iterations with the author of this PR, I finally gave the response that the author was waiting for, the looks good to me stamp of approval. And we were able to merge that PR to the master branch and then push it to production. So it was a happy ending. We were a bit tired, but finally we did it. But then a problem arrived in production. We got a bug and we discovered that it was introduced by that specific PR. So I was a bit mad because I knew that that PR asked us for a lot of work and energy, both to write the PR and also to review the PR. And despite all the time and energy that we had put, and despite the workflow that we have, which is reviewing pull requests, there were still some bugs in it. So I was like, maybe we're not doing the right workflow. So I took a step back and I said, okay, what is our workflow? Our workflow is one developer on one side writes some code during several days sometimes, and then they push a PR and they ask for somebody else of the team to review that PR. This is necessary because we want to have at least 2 pairs of eyes to watch every line of code to make sure that we can catch some bugs and even improve the quality of the code before merging to master, which is a very nice reason to do it. But in reality, because this workflow is very asynchronous and it involves 2 people that don't work at the same time, what really happens is that both the author and the reviewer juggle between different tasks. So they switch from writing this PR or reviewing this PR and possibly working on other PRs or fixing other bugs, etc. So it's very asynchronous, and for that reason, it may take some time between the day you start working on the PR and the day it gets merged. So I figured maybe we can make that cycle a bit shorter. And I went to several communities in Paris, in several meetups, to learn about how other developers solve that problem. And one of these communities is the community called Software Crafters. And this community, they came up with a lot of methodologies to think different about the workflow that we use as developers. And one of them is to, instead of working solo in an asynchronous manner, they try to work together in a synchronous manner. Okay. So this community is called Software Crafters. In order to do that, I went to several meetups in Paris and I experimented with the methodologies that they use. So we're going to go through some of them. The first one you may have heard about it. It's called pair programming. And most people think that it's just about having 2 people in front of a computer working on the same feature. Yes, but the software crafters go a bit deeper than that. They say that you must have 2 different roles. One of the engineer has to type the code and just type. And the second engineer will propose solutions to the one who types. So the roles are very separate. And in order to not make it boring for both engineers, you have to switch the roles every 10 minutes. So it means that when you develop the feature, both engineers can contribute on the how, and they also practiced the what, which is the typing the solution that was proposed by the other. So when I tried that, my first reaction was, oh my God, this is hard, because usually as a developer, I work alone and it feels like my brain is directly connected to my fingers and I think about something, I just type the code, right? And here you cannot do that anymore, because if you think, you have to express and formulate clearly what you want to do and how you want to do it so that the other person can do it. This implies that you have to make sure that the other person understands your solution and the way to implement it, which is a bit of effort compared to how I used to program. So at the end, it's more intense than working alone. It means that at the end of the day, if you do that, you end up more tired than if you work alone. But it has many benefits. Firstly, as you're two engineers working on the same feature, it means that the review happens while you write the code. Okay, so you're saving some time, and you're saving especially the asynchronous time that I was talking about before. The second thing is that as you're two developers working on this, you are two people to understand the feature that is being developed. And this is a game changer, because it means that you are not the only one to be an owner of that feature. You're actually two people being owners of that feature. Also, it's a great way to align the practices. What I mean by that is, what design patterns do you use? How do you name your functions? Like all the micro decisions that we make when we write code, we can discuss these together and we can pick one way of doing it and try to make it homogeneous, at least at the scale of the feature that we're developing. As a bonus, when I did that, I did learn a few tricks, because when I was proposing solution, the other developer was the one typing and he was typing on his own code editor, which is the same as mine, VS Code. And I discovered that we could do some refactoring. There were some refactoring features in VS Code to extract code into another function. And I didn't know about that. So that was added value for me as well. But then I went even deeper. I thought, okay, this is pretty cool, but I've heard that the software crafters also do something a bit crazy called mob programming. Mob programming is pretty simple. It's like pair programming, except that instead of being just two, you can be up to five or six on the same computer and working on the same feature at the same time. So this seems a bit insane the first time you hear it, but it actually makes some sense. I hear you. You must say, okay, if you put five engineers together, it must be a lot of discussion and we are losing a lot of time and digressing and a lot of people are sharing their opinion. Yes, but the software crafters are pretty smart. They came up with two solutions in order to prevent losing time. The first solution that they came up with is TDD. You may have heard about that, and you may think that TDD, which is test-driven development, it consists in writing the tests before writing the code, right? Well, it's not that easy. The crafters will tell you that TDD is actually a methodology that allows you to focus on one requirement at a time and try to do things as simple as possible. So it's actually a process that is not only test and implementation, it's actually a three-step process. The first step is what we call the red step. It consists of writing a test that embodies a requirement of the feature that you want to build. And this test will not pass at the beginning. It's normal, because the thing that you're testing is not yet implemented. So you start by this, right? So then when you agree on what test you wanted to implement, you go to the implementation phase, which is the green phase. We call it green because the goal of this step is to make the test pass. And one very important part about that step is that you should only write the minimum amount of code to make the test pass. And this sometimes means that you have to be very naive in the way you implement. Even sometimes you will write a if statement that matches what is in the test, right? So it will be like cheating, and that's completely okay. You have to really be minimum in that step. And after that, you refactor. Because you did probably something naive or not very clean in the green phase, after making the test pass, you give yourself the opportunity to clean the code a little bit, refactor, make sure that you don't repeat yourself in the implementation, etc. And then you go to the next requirement at the red step. And you iterate that way. So by doing this, you focus on one requirement at a time. And you don't think about like doing crazy algorithms or whatever. The second thing is that, of course, when you're pairing, and even if you're doing TDD, at some point, one of the engineers will try to over-engineer the stuff. They will tell you, oh, we can create that class, or we can, because it will be more future-proof or whatever, okay? It's pretty normal. As developers, we like complexity, and we like to like preview what will happen in the future. When this happens, and you're a software crafter, you will say YAGNI to your colleague. YAGNI stands for you aren't gonna need it. You're not going to need this, right? So you say that whenever the other engineer is going too far. And this is a reminder to say, stay focused on the test that you are solving right now. It doesn't have to be future-proof yet. So we did try that with Jérôme Schneider during the last of sprint, because we had started to work on the project together the months before. And the result of that first iteration was a huge file with a lot of code that was not documented, not tested, and it was complicated to implement all the features that we wanted to add. So we decided, okay, let's work together on this, refactor the code, make it more modular, and then we can implement the features. And he agreed that we work on this as a pair and using the TDD methodology. So we spent 6 hours pairing on this topic. At the end, we had developed 12 tests to make sure that everything worked. 3 or 4 times, we have to say YAGNI to each other because, of course, we were trying to over-engineer. And at the end, we were pretty satisfied, a bit tired, but we were very happy about how the logic was implemented. It was very clear to us, to both of us. The code base was pretty clean. We learned a few tricks here and there, and we had a lot of fun overall because we did something together. So, as you can say, I was intrigued about these methodologies, but now I'm more convinced that it's actually a promising way to work together and to do higher quality work. I will share with you some things that I did to perform and to train on this. Maybe you will be interested to follow this advice. The first one is to practice kata. Kata is the name that the software crafter give to small exercises that they do to exercise their brain on technical problems. Usually they will solve them using TDD, but sometimes they will do it in pair programming, on MOR programming, MOB programming. I will also advise to practice that on a side project. For example, if you have already written a side project and it's legacy code, there's no test, it could be a nice opportunity to write the test and make your code base comply to the test. Or it could be a brand new code base. Another thing to learn most efficiently, I will definitely recommend you to go to one of the many craft meetups in Paris. The people there are very friendly. They will teach you how to work that way, and they will guide you towards doing pair programming, mob programming, and other practices that they have. And of course, if you want to do that at Algolia, I will be more than happy to try it together. I'm not an expert. I'm still learning, but I will be very happy to try this with other people in the company. So don't hesitate if you are intrigued to contact me on Slack, Adrien Joly. I will be very happy to try that together. And that's it. Thank you.